Yes.
Seeing everybody. Tonight we'll see a full house tonight. Thank you all for coming. I'm Luann Greenwald. I'm the director of the Hilliard University Art Museum, and this is one of my favorite annual events that the museum does. So excited to have you all here. This is our third annual John Bartholomew Bienvenu Lecture, and we're thrilled tonight to have Paul Tucker with us to talk about Monet and his work from Giverny. This is really our signature event of the Hilliard Museum, and it's all thanks to a very special person who's with us here tonight, Gloria Kelly. Gloria made a really generous gift to honor her brother John and his artistic legacy, and that's what has made this event possible each year. And Gloria, we just want to say thank you so much. We have a bouquet of flowers here for you. And we're presenting it to you in a beautiful pot by Susan Chickley, who I saw. The mugs that Susie made, so we thought you'd love that pot. I also want to welcome members of the Bienvenu family. It's wonderful to have so many of you here with us today, so thank you for being here. I want to say thank you to the Hilliard Society, who hosted the beautiful reception we had earlier this evening. How many Hilliard Society members are here tonight? Thank you all. Dean Gordon Brooks.
No.
Thanks to him, we are here in this hall tonight. You may remember if you came to the lecture last year, we had over 100 people, and we were crammed into our small flex space at the museum. So we've expanded, and I think we're going to have to find an even bigger auditorium for next year. And I want to say thanks also to Gordon and the College of Art for advertising our event as part of their Festival of the Arts. So for all of you art enthusiasts, there's lots of programming going on this month, and I encourage you to pick up the calendar and enjoy some of those activities. I also want to say thanks to Robert and Jolie Shelton, who hosted a wonderful lunch for our guests today. To our sponsors, Site Tech, and to Acadiana Open Channel, who's actually filming tonight. So you'll be able to So this lecture is in honor of Gloria's brother, John Bartholomew Bienvenu. John was a professional psychologist, a teacher, an artist, a world traveler, and a beloved father, brother, and friend. In retirement, he dedicated himself to the arts through classes, workshops, and teaching. And his colorful watercolors were inspired by the French Impressionists, and in turn inspired the recurring theme of this lecture series of French Impressionism, continuing in tonight's talk. So tonight's event is also a bit of a teaser. We have a couple of things coming up at the Hilliard Museum related to this. We have a summer exhibition of the work of Pierre Bonnard, a French post-impressionist artist, and we'll be presenting sketches and paintings from his museum, Musée Bonnard, located in Lucanet, France. Lucanet is a sister city to Lafayette. So that exhibition will be opening at the end of May and will be up through August. So I encourage you all to see that. It's a very special opportunity. We are the exclusive venue for this exhibition. And then the second little treat coming up is at the end of September, we're going to be taking a trip to France, a 10-day trip. So we'll be flying into Paris, spending an evening in Aix-en-Provence, and then several days on the French Riviera. So the itinerary will be coming out soon, so I encourage you all to save the date, September 18th through the 28th. And finally, it's my privilege to introduce Paul Tucker. Paul Hayes Tucker is Professor Emeritus at the University of Massachusetts, Boston, where he taught for 36 years after earning his PhD in art history from Yale. He served on the faculties of the Institute of Fine Arts at NYU, the University of California, Santa Barbara, and Williams College, his alma mater. A specialist in 19th and 20th century art, Tucker is considered the world's leading authority on Claude Monet. He has written and edited 11 books, curated more than half a dozen international exhibitions, and contributed numerous essays to museum catalogs and art historical publications. Paul has received numerous academic awards, has been heard many times on NPR, and has appeared frequently on TV, including Good Morning America, The Today Show, and Charlie Rose. Now a resident of Santa Barbara, he's writing a textbook on modern art. So following Paul's lecture, he's offered to do a book signing, so we'll have a table set up outside. I think we have about 9 copies of Monet in the 90s because his books are out of print, they're sold out. So I encourage you all to make haste at the end of the lecture. Get yourself a book and get Paul to sign it. And just as a bit of housekeeping, if anybody needs to use the restroom, it's across the plaza, go through the doors, and it's to the left of the screen from the gallery across the way. So please join me in welcoming Paul.
Thank you very much, Luann, and thank you, Gloria, for making this possible. It's really a great treat to be here in Lafayette. It's my first time here in these parts, and it has been nothing other than pure bliss, particularly not only because of the fantastic food, we are going home to starve ourselves, my wife and I, after this, but as they would say, buyer beware, and we are fully aware of the glories of the cuisine that are here and couldn't be more grateful. I'm also very pleased to have my wife here of 43 years, Maggie. Who is, together with Mr. Monet, one of my great inspirations. In fact, she says that she's actually married to 2 men, but one of them just doesn't happen to be here any longer. I'm never quite sure who she's referring to, however, in that particular regard. In any case, I have the privilege to be able to speak with you this evening for approximately 55 minutes or so upon this man who has been my companion for many years, almost 40, but who's counting? We see him in 2 photographs here, one taken in the middle of the 1880s there upon the left-hand side, and one taken around 1900 when he was 60 years old. The one on the left is when he's in his mid-40s. And it reveals a number of things, as I hope tonight's evening will also concur, which is to say that the man on the left-hand side is a man who is there, comfortable in rural France. He's got his floppy hat on. He's got that wonderful jacket that hangs deep. He's got his clogs on, the wooden clogs down below, and he feels like a man of the people. The one on the right-hand side, however, he's quite different. He is there in that rather fancy bowler hat. His beard is now turning slightly gray. It's well combed. And look at that fantastic suit that he has on, complete down to a cravat underneath that hoary beard and a wonderful shower, as my father used to say, which is the handkerchief in your pocket, your breast pocket, which is in contrast to the blower, which is in your back pocket. But particularly apparent, too, in this photograph, look at the bottom of the photograph where you see very carefully pressed cuffs on his shirt and those marvelous check pants which he had ordered from an English tailor, just like the suit above. He was a man who actually fancied fine clothing, something the picture on the left-hand side would appear to deny. But in point of fact, if we look at him even earlier, for example, when he's in his 30s, here upon the left-hand side, a photograph taken around 1870 or 71, you can see that he's housing all of those same qualities that he reveals in the photograph there upon the right. The handsome, dapper man whose hair I am jealous of. His marvelous cravat there once again. Look at how perfectly cut that jacket is too. The pants very handsomely arranged, and the vest underneath it, which of course appropriately dapper in its design. People said that actually he was always this way and loved, even when he was later in life at Giverny, even when he was painting, to have ruffled cuffs and have, of course, a kind of costume that was seen to be the contrary of an artist devoted to nature and pursuing those instantaneous effects of which Impressionism is so well renowned. But these are some of the contradictions of this artist, who was born in 1840 and lived until 1926, which means, therefore, that he spent a great deal of his life in the 20th century. We always think of him really as being a 19th century artist, but in point of fact, he spent, as I say, a considerable amount of time here in the 20th century. He also was a man who was actually quite successful in his life. Not right at the beginning, of course, but more often than not, he was actually making money. And when it came to Giverny, where he moved to in 1883, he began making a great deal of money, particularly in the 1890s, as we'll see a little bit later on, from making his infamous series paintings, sold extremely well, enough to be able to allow him to purchase not one, but two very large limousines, one of which you see here upon the left, with him seated in the back seat. He did not drive, he had his driver chauffeur him around the countryside, and he loved to speed across those beautiful lands of France at high percentages of the odometer. So too did his wife, Alice Hochaudet, who in fact not only loved cruising around the countryside at high speeds, but really enjoyed going to wrestling matches in Paris. Now, you wouldn't put Monet, the artist, in wrestling matches and cars and high speeds together, but that was, in fact, the man. Indeed, he was someone who was a very worldly individual. We don't think of him as someone who's engaged all the time in contemporary affairs, but he was, almost on a daily basis. He read the newspaper constantly. In fact, this is a portrait of Monet in the 1870s, when he's in his 30s, reading the newspaper painted by his friend Renoir. Not only did he keep up with current events and read contemporary, not only magazines and novels, but he also later in life played the stock market. He was constantly placing bets on companies from his home in Giverny, and therefore not there in some kind of rural retreat, but constantly in touch with the flux and flow of his day. So much so that he actually subscribed to a press clipping service so that the service could cut him from newspapers where his name had appeared. These press clipping service clippings are actually still extant. They are at the Musée Marmottan in Paris, and they reveal from the late 1880s all the way through to the 1920s his keen interest in following his role and his persona within the French Parisian press. He was someone who also had sometimes different ideas about the way in which one is supposed to conduct one's life. For example, painting here upon the left-hand side is a painting by the American artist Theodore Robinson, who became a very good friend of Monet's in the 1890s. And it shows, in fact, an American painter, Theodore Butler, who had come to Giverny and who had taken up with Monet's stepdaughter and eventually married her, and that is what is being memorialized in this painting, which is in the Terra Museum of American Art in Chicago. Now, this would all seem fairly normal. However, Monet, in his inimical way, was quite upset about the possibilities of these nuptials. Why? First, Theodore Butler had not come to him and asked for his daughter's hand, which you would think a bohemian artist such as Monet would have not bothered with, but he actually had very bourgeois values in that regard. Secondly, and even more humorously, is the fact that he was a little upset that she was going to be marrying a painter, that somehow or other she could do better than being with an artist for the rest of his life. There's one other dimension to all of this too, and that is they got married in 1890. Monet at the time had been living with the mother of this girl. As I said, she was Monet's stepdaughter. But she only became his stepdaughter a week before this wedding event occurred. And that's because Monet and Alice Hochaudet were living in what used to be called sin. And they had been living together actually since the almost the 1870s, late 1870s. And Alice Hochaudet, the mother, felt very strongly, and I'm sure Monet did too, that Monet should walk his quote-unquote stepdaughter down the aisle. But in point of fact, Monet obviously was not married to the mother, so therefore he couldn't really do that officially within the canons of the church. So a week before the wedding of his eventual stepdaughter, he marries Alice Hochaudet, and it all became resolved. The other thing that is always interesting to remember is that Impressionism is categorized in many ways, but it is certainly renowned for the fact that we all believe or want to believe, and the artists themselves propagated the belief, that these paintings, so fresh and vibrant in their color, so lively in their brushwork, were all painted spontaneously out of doors, moved as these artists were by the beauties of nature as a whole. And indeed, many pictures were constructed as such, and in fact, we have proof of that in various ways. Here on the left-hand side is a painting by John Singer Sargent, the great American painter, a picture which is actually in the collection of the Museum of Fine Arts in Boston. And there is Monet, Sargent's pal, painting out of doors in Giverny, and he's actually painting a picture that we are able to identify. It's a landscape painting, which is also at the Museum of Fine Arts in Boston. But the fact actually is, as Robert Herbert, my great mentor at Yale, revealed many years ago, that most of the times these pictures were not finished out of doors. They're too complicated. They're too constructed. They're too regularized. Sure, some of them are sketches and they retain some of that instantaneity so associated with Impressionism, but almost all of them are finished in the studio. Even the great New Yorker magazine understood this a while ago and in fact created this marvelous cartoon. It might be a little difficult to read down below, but it says, there's Monet with all of his paints and his wife and the water lilies in the background. And it says, a decisive moment in the history of art. Monet discovers that a haystack is not at its best under artificial light. In a moment, he'll take it outside again. It really is a debunking of this myth, which is very difficult to debunk, because we all want to believe that these things were done out of doors in this freshness and in this kind of instantaneity. But those are the artistic tricks, the little ploys that these artists employed throughout their life. Indeed, there are even photographs, and we're not quite sure why Monet allowed this photograph to be taken and published, but this is a photograph taken from 1915 of him finishing a painting, which is now in the Phoenix Art Museum, of his water lily pond at Giverny. And it was published in a magazine in Paris. At one point in time, Monet said, it really doesn't make any difference how I paint these pictures. It's all really about the finished look itself, about the final product. So there's a certain, if you will, perhaps sense of loss sometimes about thinking that they're not the product of this instant moment in front of nature. Just like, in fact, we have to realize that people like Rodin, Monet's great friend, never carved any of the marbles that are associated with his name. And he never touched the marbles. One of the most famous of the Kiss, never touched it. And that's because he farmed that work out to Italian stonecutters. Why should Rodin, the master, the genius, why should he spend all of that time carving this stone when he could in fact be out there thinking up other ideas and making models for those stonecutters to actually then execute? And it's really a part of the notion of the genius of the artist embedded in the making and the concetti, the ideas itself. We like to think the artist touched it, but it's not always the case. Something which obviously comes much more into play in the 20th century. Be that as it may, of course, one of the most important works from Monet's hand, his late water lilies, or Grand Décoration as they are called, which are now in the marvelous two-room museum in the Angerie in the heart of Paris, all of those were done in the studio. Even though they breathe with the air of his pond and have all of the fluctuations of nature and its permutations. But they all were done there in the studio, which, alas, if you have been to Giverny, you know that the studio has been converted largely into a gift shop. But again, be that as it may, it is simply a reminder that there is a great deal, if you will, of trickery, so to speak, not to deceive you, but nonetheless to be able to make a work that is going to look like one thing, but actually be constructed in another way. One of the other things about Monet which is marvelous to consider is the fact that even his own biography is conflicted or filled with contrasts. As I said, he was born in 1840, and he was born in Paris. He loved the notion throughout his life that he said, I'm a Parisian, I was born under great Louis Philippe, and he really felt as if his roots were there in the city. a city which he rendered many times, never perhaps more vibrantly or more beautifully than in this picture from 1867, a group of three pictures that he did in that year that show, in this particular case, the Seine there in the middle ground, further, the bridge cutting diagonally across the surface there is the one of the oldest bridges in Paris. And up above, crowning the congestion of houses, is the Pantheon, the great 18th century building that had been changed from a religious structure into a secular structure during the French Revolution. So it reeks of Paris in all of its ways. Now, it also is a picture which he painted in 1867 standing on a balcony of the Louvre. The Louvre itself is right behind him. And as Joel Isaacson, a wonderful art historian from the University of Michigan, pointed out many years ago, that he literally, in many ways, is turning his back on the past and embracing the present, leaving all of those works of art, those dusty old masters behind him, and looking out at the fluctuations of modern life there within this burgeoning city of Paris. One other thing to consider, and that is that it is painted in 1867. As I'm sure some of you know, in 1867, there was a large World's Fair in Paris. And in fact, these pictures were therefore painted for sale, as all of his pictures were, but in this particular case, for a kind of tourist sale, for the hope that people coming for the exhibition would in fact purchase something like this, like a Canaletto if you went to Italy, and take it home with them. It didn't quite happen that way, but nonetheless, that really was part of Monet's intentions. However, Monet only lived in Paris as a child. He didn't really experience Paris as a teenager. In fact, his family moved to the Normandy coast when he was just a small boy, and it was along the Normandy coast, which I show you a drawing of there upon the right, a drawing probably made in his early teenage years, that he adored. And he always felt close to the Normandy coast and to the channel, the English Channel. It was deeply embedded in his soul and in his spirit. In fact, he said one time that if he died, he wanted to be buried in a buoy. So the idea, which to me as a landlubber sounds absolutely terrible, but the fact actually is that he was a man really of the sea. He loved the ocean. Even during the First World War, as the guns were blaring, he actually had his driver drive him in one of those limousines up to Normandy so that he could smell the air of the sea. So important was that to him. So he's a man of the city, he claims, but he's a man of the country as well. Two obviously opposite affairs. A third sort of contrast is the fact that some of his earliest work, besides these drawings, are caricatures. There are hundreds of these caricatures. And some of them are very funny, and some of them are very nasty in terms of the way that he depicts various individuals. Like, for example, the person on the upper left-hand side there was actually a local painter in the town of Le Havre, where he lived just outside in Saint-Adresse, and is a kind of mocking of the old painter there, as if the young buck is going to come along and push him off the stage, a kind of competition that was innate to Monet. He was a very competitive man, even with himself. But he would copy other kinds of caricatures, which were very popular at the time in magazines and the like, of politicians, such as those down below over there. And it reminds us that not only is he engaged with contemporanity, and with individuals of his time, but he was a terrific draftsman. He's very good at rendering these forms. He always sort of denied or played down his own draftsmanship, but it is evident in drawing after drawing that he had a real facility for this. It also shows that he had a humorous side too, and a kind of sardonic side, something once again we don't necessarily associate with this nature-loving artist. One of the things, too, that is really important to understand is that he was a very calculating guy, as many artists are, but he was particularly gifted at this in all kinds of ways. For example, the painting I show you here upon the left is a painting at the Kimball Museum in Fort Worth, Texas. It's a large painting, it's a beautiful painting, and it's the very first painting that Monet submitted to the Salon, that great gathering on an annual basis in Paris that was the largest, most important examination of contemporary art in France, indeed in Europe. And to get into the salon, as some of you know, you had to go through a jury process, be judged. To get in there was a huge triumph. Monet got in there with this particular picture. But he had waited for almost 5 years, maybe even longer than that, plotting his way, trying to figure out what would be the best picture to paint to be able to break this barrier and to gain recognition, which was almost inevitable from getting in there. He also chose a subject which is relatively traditional, a kind of beach scene here with gatherers and fishermen, a palette which unfortunately is not so revealed in this image, but which is subdued in grays and browns, none of that kind of vibrancy that will be a part of his work in just a few years, and none of the kind of contrast, not only of color, but also of touch. The touch is very restrained and therefore within the norms for what would have been expected of a landscape painter in the middle of the 1860s. So he triumphs. He's very smart. He figures it out. And he decides, okay, after having gotten this picture in, a picture which was recognized by critics, cited in the press. There was even a drawing of it in one particular publication. So it was really a huge leap into the world of modern and contemporary art. What does he do the following year? Well, the following year, he takes an exact opposite turn. He starts painting a huge painting, a picture which was going to be 20 feet long, which I show you here up in the upper right-hand side, 20 feet by about 10 feet high, and it was going to show a contemporary scene of men and women in absolutely au courant dress. They could have stepped right out of Vogue or Mademoiselle or whatever of their day. And all set in the forest of Fontainebleau with light that is so tangible that you could feel it flickering through the leaves in the upper registers of the picture and scattering itself across the ground or across the gowns. Look at the woman on the left-hand side with those big touches of white against the black lacy design of her train, of her dress. It is so tangible. It's almost like, and forgive me, it's almost like for when the first big screen movies came out, the kind of Metro-Golden-Mayer, Ben-Hur movies, that this was going to be so palpable, so real, that it was going to, of course, shock the public itself, something which he had desired to do in now having gained credence, so to speak, from a picture which could not have been more opposite. When he takes on this particular subject, he is taking on not only a contemporary subject, but a subject that also had just been treated by none other than Edouard Manet, A as opposed to O. And in 1864, just the year prior to Monet taking up this project, Manet had exhibited in the Salon des Refusés a picture here upon the left-hand side, which I'm sure is familiar to many of you, of a Déjeuner sur l'herbe, or as it was called when it was first exhibited, simply Le Bain, or the bath. The Déjeuner sur l'herbe came in afterwards. In any case, it was a picture that had been rejected from the normal salon, but because there were so many pictures that had been rejected, Napoleon III, the Emperor of France, had decreed the opportunity for any artist who had been thrown out of the legitimate one to be able to show his or her picture in the Salon of Refused Pictures, which itself was a little dangerous because they were already refused. So if you're going to be putting your picture in front of the public, you can say, well, of course I was refused. I mean, now you, the public, can be great critics because you know that the judges have already refused that picture, so it can't really be any good. This particular painting created a great stir, as some of you know, largely because she is buck naked, she is looking at you, and she knows that you are looking at her, and she is looking at you, and you are looking at her, and there's a standoff in terms of that stare. And the two men on either side seem not even to recognize that she's there, which of course is completely un-French. And on top of that, in the background, there's a woman in her chiton who is actually taking a bath. As I said, the poor woman in the foreground here must be sitting there shivering because she clearly maybe had taken a bath before but had forgotten to put her clothes on. In fact, she's sitting on her clothes. That is her dress that she is sitting on, which is also another defilement of protocol and prominency. In any case, there are many mysteries that surround this picture. To this very day, we actually don't know exactly what this picture means. But it's part of the great powers of Manet that allows for continual exploration. In Monet's case, In fact, everything is very straightforward. He strips it of references to Renaissance art, to the past. He strips it of all the ambiguity and the metaphors and presents it just as it is. A kind of, as they say, topos of his moment, a kind of embrace of his time, which seems to be quite the opposite of this love of landscapes along the Normandy coast. There's also another dimension to him from the 1860s. He painted lots of still lifes. Still lifes which are oftentimes quite obscure. I love in particular the one here on the left-hand side with this boar's head. This is an outrageous painting that also includes probably the weapon of destruction, that huge knife there upon the right, swiped clean of the blood and guts and hair of that boar, but nobody painted a still life like this. It just didn't occur. Or the picture in the upper right-hand corner, these fantastic peaches that have been pierced by cinnamon sticks and then placed in this liquid there to be able to mull. A couple of peaches didn't make it into the bowl there upon the right, but look at the marble of that surface that he's rendered with a kind of dexterity in terms of moving that white brush so daringly across that black surface to give the ultimate impression of its tactility and of the coolness and density of that material. Anyway, he's a fantastic still life painter. In fact, by the 1880s, 10% of his work were still lifes. Again, something little less known. One other thing, too, is that the very first painting that is attributed to him is a picture from 1858, when he's 18 years old. Could have been 17, actually. It's a picture which is fairly modest in size, but is very beautiful and very accomplished. It is filled with extraordinary range of greens. The space is absolutely clear and understandable. The clouds and that blue surface of the sky is utterly delectable. If it were in that wonderful exhibition or a wonderful program of the Muppets, some of you may have seen, the Muppets go to the Met. The Muppets inevitably would have jumped into this landscape, licked that water, and had a marvelous time. It's just that delicious a painting. Now, I emphasize this because this is the first painting that we know of from his hand. There had to be dozens upon dozens, indeed probably hundreds of other paintings that preceded this, because this is simply too accomplished as a painting to remain there isolated as his first essay. And there were probably hundreds of other drawings likewise. We do have some, but not very many. And we know from various records that he drew a great deal. Those have been lost to history, alas, unless perhaps some might turn up here in Louisiana where some of these things do occur. In any case, it's just a reminder that it's a more complicated picture than the normal history that is written of Monet and or Impressionism. In fact, it gets even more complicated because the very earliest works within the first 10 paintings that we know and that are documented, there are several that are actually, like these two here, pictures which don't seem to be Impressionist at all, and certainly don't seem to be by Monet. They're of factories in this kind of abandoned landscape. Look at the paltry trees here upon the picture in the upper left-hand side, or this very strange, ambiguous kind of folding set of hills in the picture there upon the right. Industrial and yet at the same time curiously unattractive in traditional notions of attraction, but he painted about four of these pictures, only two of which we know their whereabouts. We have documents as to other ones. But it couldn't be further from this luscious, beautiful, kind, gentle, inviting, seductive landscape that is supposed to be his first painting. Indeed, if one looks across the first two decades of his work in his 20s and 30s, the 1860s and 1870s, you find that there are dozens of industrial pictures. Pictures like the ones I show you here upon the screen, where factory chimneys spew out their smoke, engines from locomotive contrast with snow and with other forms in the painting itself, or factories themselves depicted there in the far right-hand side in the middle, as if they are somehow or other to be embraced and to be worthy of being made into art. These things for obviously existed in the world, but to declare their access and entrance into the refined realm of art, particularly French art, where subject matter makes such a difference, is an enormous breakthrough for someone like Monet or anybody else for that matter. In fact, right at the very center of this collection is, of course, one of the most famous Impressionist paintings of all, a picture by Monet painted in 1872 called Impression Sunrise, which is also at the Musée Marmottan in Paris. It's a picture which, if anything from this evening's lecture you will take home with you, and there is a little quiz, I have to say, that you have to take before you leave. It is open book, it's all right. But that this particular picture is so often associated with Impressionism that it is constantly being told, you're told, that it gave Impressionism its name because it's called Impression Sunrise. It simply isn't true. And in 25 years of trying to be able to convince people and get the word out, it simply hasn't fully happened. So I rely upon you to be able to make sure those here in Louisiana at least understand that. And the reason I emphasize this is twofold. One is because the word Impressionism and Impressionism as a whole had been used frequently previous to this exhibition of 1874 when this painting was first exhibited in what became known as the first Impressionist exhibition. But it came from a critic who was looking at a variety of paintings. Yes, he criticized this particular picture, thought it was a terrible painting, and so on and so forth, but it was not directly the source of the name itself. In any case, small aside, the fact is that when you look at the picture, which had rarely been actually examined in detail, and when you see it in the context of these other industrial pictures, you'll note there on the left-hand side in the background, you have huge smokestacks and smoke pouring out into the sky. On the right-hand side, you have various diagonals. Those are actually cranes that are both taking cargo out of ships and, in fact, expanding the port itself. We're looking at the port of Le Havre, which Monet knew very well since he grew up right outside of it. And it is an expansion that had begun in the late 1860s, was terminated for a while by the War of 1870, but taken up again in 1871 after the armistice was signed. Monet paints this in 1872, and what is he doing? He's celebrating many things. He's celebrating the revivification of France as a whole after the disasters of the Franco-Prussian War, which they lost in a terrible format. He's also celebrating the fact that these industries are fine, that in fact this smoke is going to mix with the density of the air across the English Channel and create these beautiful orange sunsets and, suns and these orange skies as well. That all of this is good and that the human has a place and a role in this. There is a small fishing boat in the foreground and all of that is fine. That this is a modern world of contrasts and contradictions that we should embrace, and that Impressionism, as the newest movement in France, should likewise have at its centerpiece. The fact actually is, too, that we know from photographs of the place here upon the left-hand side, photograph taken actually in the 1860s, that this was a highly industrialized site. All of that smoke and fog is coming from the actual physical locale itself, something that Zola celebrated likewise, too, in La Bête Humaine, a novel that he had written in the 1860s. And the opening section of the first chapter is set here in Le Havre, describing all the rattle of these factories and all of the smoke therein. In addition, what Monet is doing is not only looking directly at the present cold-eyed and warm-hearted, but he's also looking to the past, to people like Claude Lorrain, who was the great 17th century French landscape painter who painted port scenes like what you see here upon the left-hand side, which had gained him the rightful credit of being France's greatest landscape painter, a mantle, a title that Monet wants to snatch from his predecessor. Because he, Monet, wants to be able to be recognized as the great French contemporary landscape painter, something we'll see in a few minutes that he actually achieves. Part of that achievement, part of that effort, is in fact memorialized in various ways. One of the most renowned and most telling is this painting by Edouard Manet, now in Germany, a picture which shows Monet. Again, look how dapper he is in that groovy straw hat, very Beauterre, very English, with the cravat there again, very classy pants. His wife, Camille, is there inside this little studio boat that he had built so he could actually paint out on the Seine. He's painting a picture there upon his easel, a picture which is actually, we can identify again. It is actually a picture which is now hanging at the San Francisco Museums of Fine Arts. And it shows Argenteuil, the suburb outside of Paris, where Monet moved to in 1872 and remained there until 1878, more or less 6 years. It is a picture which shows him as the consummate modern artist. Not only is he dressed very handsomely with his muse, his wife, a kind of metaphor, but he's right there in the rock and roll of his moment, literally in terms of the way the water is painted and with the factory chimneys there in the background, because the cheaper land right outside of Paris, Argenteuil was only 15 minutes by train from the Gare Saint-Lazare, as it still is today. I urge you to go. It's quite a marvelous to walk around and think that Monet actually sat on these various sites. His house is right there too. You can visit his house. But here he is, right in the center of his moment, rendering it in theory with a kind of forthrightness that is evident from Manet's own picture of his good friend as the modern landscape painter. Now, these contradictions play themselves out during the 1870s. It begins, of course, with the picture here upon the left, painted in 1872, right when Monet arrives in this wonderful suburban town. Couldn't be more beautiful, couldn't be more inviting. The picture literally with these triangle of the path there invites us right down the path as it's crossed by these utterly delectable pinks and yellows. It's almost like that candy you get at Easter, all that ribbon candy that is so delectable as well. You then, the convergence of those lines are right there at the house that you as an individual aspiring bourgeois would want to have in the countryside, a beautiful mansard house. And yes, on either side there are factories, but no big deal. The sky is blue, clouds are clear. There's also boating here upon the placid waters of the Seine, boating which was brand new to France. So Monet, including boating in a picture, is actually also embracing contemporaneity, even in that part of the subject. The picture itself is so tightly constructed. Look at not only the triangle of the pathway coming through, but which is then echoed in the wedge of the water. The water then creates with the trees in the background a very strict line for a horizon right across to create a kind of, if you will, a rectangle that is imitated by the rectangle of the sky, which is then inverted with the rectangle of the trees there upon the right. It's almost, in fact, if you map this out, it's almost like a Mondrian from the 20th century. The picture on the right-hand side is quite different. It's in fact the exact same place. He's standing on exactly the same site. That house in the distance is the very same house with that turret. The trees on the right are the trees that you see here upon the right-hand side as well. Yes, he's moved slightly further down the bank, and the flowers in the foreground writhe as they cross the scene itself, blocking our entrance into this picture now. In fact, there's no way to get into the picture. And when one looks at the painting itself too, even the little fence there upon the lower right-hand side holds us in retreat. Essentially, he is describing a divided world, a world that could still give rise to golden illusions about modernity. People are still there on the banks in the background. People would still want that house. But for Monet, it no longer was satisfactory. And it was no longer satisfactory because Argenteuil, the town itself, had changed. It had almost doubled in population during the time that he was there, largely through workers coming to man factories which were going up on the very same fields that he had painted that formerly had been open. And so therefore this kind of notion of somehow or other the integration of the industrial and the human, of the natural and the progressive, really in the end for him as a landscape painter could not work. What does he do? He leaves. And he goes eventually to Giverny, and he paints during the 1880s a whole variety of sites in France. He goes, for example, to Belle Isle here on the left-hand side, a very mountainous, courageous, and a dramatic site on this island just off the coast of Brittany, where the pounding seas of the Atlantic carved out these needle rocks, which themselves are extraordinarily rough and quite high. They're like 30-odd feet high. So when you stand on the shores there and look down, you look down a precipice with considerable danger therein. He also goes to the south of France as if he wants to cover the entire nation. And he goes to Antibes and to Bordighera, what he wants to do is to be able to show that Impressionism, under his guise and his watch, can be a legion to all of France. And in fact, it can be a national style, something which had begun to occur because there were many people who began to imitate Impressionism as a whole, and which Monet, of course, was recognized as the ultimate leader thereof. And then at the end of the 1880s and into the 1890s, he clarifies and enhances all of this through his series paintings, pictures which begin with the stack pictures there upon the left, and from 1890 through poplar pictures down below over there, through cathedral pictures of 1895, all of which were greeted with keen enthusiasm by almost everybody. They marveled at the way that he was able to manipulate his paint to capture the extraordinary variety of light and atmosphere and color, and to be able to render traditional French subjects. Nothing is more French than a Gothic cathedral. It was invented on the Île-de-France in the 10th century. It was propagated for centuries thereafter. It was imitated by every country in Europe. It was even imitated by we here in America. So therefore, it is deeply rooted in the notion of the country itself. Monet was a complete agnostic. Of course, he was raised as a Catholic, and as some of you may know, there is a classic line, once a Catholic, always a Catholic. Some of us suffer with that, we understand that. Monet came to some kind of grips about that, but he didn't paint this cathedral as a believer. In fact, he didn't even go into the church until the cheapskate got a free ticket to a 300 voice choir that had come from Paris to sing in the cathedral. And he goes in and he writes a letter to his wife. He's marveling at how beautiful the inside is, right? But that was not what he was interested in. What he was interested in, of course, is the way in which the natural phenomena of atmosphere and light and color transform the stone of this cathedral so that, as Robert Herbert pointed out long ago, so that the cathedral actually becomes a facade literally for the powers of nature, not for the dogmas of the church. That actually the kind of stained glass wonders of the interior now are on the outside thanks to the marvelous transformative powers of the world as a whole, which then allows him, the artist, to actually therefore enroll as the priest of this version. Artist becomes priest, exterior becomes interior, religion is transformed into nature. He, through these paintings, is actually awarded that very title that I mentioned a little bit ago. In 1898, with these other series paintings, there's a whole series of articles about him in the Paris press, this one in particular, gathering up lots of reviews from the previous decade of all of his shows. And he is declared there, see the, again, those wonderful check pants and that wonderful same bowler hat that we saw earlier. He is declared to be the great French contemporary landscape painter. He made it. He's going to go down in history as he always had wanted to do, and of course he probably would have, but now it is truly confirmed and memorialized. 1898. By this time, he's painted close to 2,000 paintings. An enormously productive individual, as hard on himself as he would be on anybody else. 1898. From 1898 onwards, he will paint another approximately 500 paintings. Only about a dozen of them show a French site. And all of those concentrate upon the small town of Vétheuil, where he had moved to in 1879 after leaving Argenteuil, and where his wife died and was buried. They're all painted in 1900. They're all kind of nostalgic pictures, evoking this town, that moment, sense of loss and transformation. But those are the only paintings that actually you could identify as being French. And the question is, to my mind, why is that the case? Here he had propagated this kind of notion from the very beginning of his career, with great enthusiasm and complete conviction. It seems that there's only really one answer. As many of you, I'm sure, know, in 1898, France was roiled by what became known as the Dreyfus Affair, when the Jewish captain in the army, Alfred Dreyfus, was wrongly accused of selling military secrets to the Prussians, the hated Prussians across the line, the Rhine. He was tried and convicted in 1895. Evidence came forward several years later saying that this was not true. He was tried again in late 1870, 1897 and 98. He was convicted yet again, and it was an event that truly divided the nation. And it divided the nation because it was based upon all the principles that was so important to the nation. Loyalty, honor, respect, a sense of tradition, the army itself, and religion. It caused not only extraordinary division in the nation, also in families, not so unlike what we are suffering at the moment, but likewise too, it caused for ruptures in the way the people thought about art. Monet among them. There were heinous things that were published in the press, like this, the Museum of Horrors over here, the traitor, and that's a picture of Dreyfus there upon the left-hand side. Dreyfus's sword was broken in front of the École Militaire in Paris itself, the most degrading aspect for a military man. It was an event that literally put people at each other's throats. Here we are at the dining room table up above over there, and as soon as the word Dreyfus comes up, it becomes a kind of insane situation. This was so deep and so profound and so altering that it wasn't until the 1990s, 100 years later, that the French army formally apologized to the Dreyfus family. Took 100 years for them to apologize. So heinous was this, so deeply rooted was this resentment. What does Monet do? As I say, he stops painting French subjects. He, quote unquote, retreats to his garden at Giverny, where he had moved to in 1883. He bought the property in 1890, and he lived there from 1890 until his death in 1926. And he paints gorgeous pictures like this flower picture there upon the right-hand side. He paints his own house in this marvelous set of colors. If some of you have been there, you know the intensity of that yellow in the kitchen, and the dining room rather, the blues of the kitchen, his bedroom here upon the left-hand side, the blues of his sitting room and the like. It becomes a kind of work of art in and of itself, a kind of installation, so to speak. But most important is that he transforms the actual acreage of his place. The house you can see there in the upper left-hand corner there, the gardens which he bought, or the land which he bought, had essentially been kitchen gardens, vegetables and fruits and the like. When he bought it in 1890, he ripped all of that out and made it into a pleasure garden for the eyes, so to speak, merely flowers, totally impractical in the end. And then he was able, a couple of years later, to buy land on the other side of that blue line, which is actually a road that also contained a railroad. He bought the land on the other side and began building in 1893 the water lily pond for which he became so famous. But it has to be remembered that he actually had to cross that road and cross a railroad on which a train ran two times a day from Mont in Paris. So it wasn't as if he's in some kind of la-la retreat Shangri-La. He's actually constantly reminded of the fact that he's connected to the real world, even though the pond that he built, as some of you know undoubtedly, is just unbelievably beautiful, exotic, and without the tourists, extraordinarily seductive. He planted all of these trees, and when one of them cracked and died in a windstorm around 1910, it broke his heart, as if he had lost a child. He tended to this garden with enormous attention, actually transforming it several times over the course of a decade. He even, of course, had one of his gardeners, he had multiple gardeners there, he had one of his gardeners every morning go out to dunk the water lilies because they had too much dust on them. Because the road there, you know, as people went down the road, kicked up dust, very annoying. And he wanted them to glisten in all their perfection. So annoyed did he get by the dust on his water lilies that he actually helped to pay for the town to pave the road so he wouldn't have to worry about it anymore. So this garden is a completely self-created entity, again, like his house, almost in some ways like a kind of first earthwork. And he paints it over and over again. He crosses it with a Japanese bridge, one taken, so to speak, from a Hokusai Japanese print. He collected hundreds of these Japanese prints, feeling like many people in France that all Japanese artists, mistakenly, but nonetheless all Japanese artists, actually began as landscape painters. And therefore, they're close to nature and understood its vagarities. The garden was, as I say, the site of almost all of his attention from more or less 1900 through to his death in 1926. He does take time and paint several series of pictures of London, which he shows in 1904, but essentially it is this garden which is his focus. And when he paints it around 1903 and 1904, he looks down upon that surface, this wonderful watery surface, shifting in various ways. The one picture here upon the left-hand side is in a private collection in Dallas, which has often been exhibited at the Dallas Museum. It's a picture which Monet actually referenced several years after he sold it. And he said, I wish I had that painting back because I would have destroyed it. Now, it seems impossible that he would have wanted to do that because the picture is just remarkably finished. It is so gorgeous in every aspect. But I suspect that he probably felt it was too beautiful. It was too decorative. It was too accessible. He's very concerned about making a picture that is still going to have tendons. It's going to have a kind of muscle to it. It's going to have a jolt to it. Because essentially, if you abandon all subject and you're just painting the surface of the water and your little water lilies, there's not a lot there to give it a kind of monumentality or a kind of heft. What he does is, as you can see in this slide here, is he tips the waters up upon the surface. So he removes the very reassuring bank that you have there in the left-hand side. So now the painting is only about the water and about those reflections and about the very strong contrast between reflections, surface, and depth. So you have things that are outside the picture, which are being conditioned. You have things right there upon the surface that are trying to be rendered. And then the plumbing and the depths of that water as well. He paints these over and over again. But in fact, we think of them as a kind of continuous series. It's not the case. Every year, he's figuring out a different kind of proposition. Because as I said, he's as hard on himself as he is on anybody else. And even though these probably would have sold like hotcakes, we know that from his dealer who wanted to push them, that he wasn't quite ready. So he would move water lilies around, change color, change aspects of the surface as well in terms of atmosphere and so on. He would even test formats. He did four paintings that are round, like one which is at the Dallas Museum, which I show you here upon the left, and others which are vertical rectangles. Now, the round ones actually don't work so well. They're like portals, you know, as if they sort of break the wall. When you put them on the wall, you have to be very careful about what else you put around them. So, and they too are very decorative, taken as they are, really from 18th century Rococo formats. But he wanted to try it out, see what it was going to be like. He then ingeniously takes a horizontal rectangle, which he had worked with continuously, turns it vertical, and paints pictures like this one there upon the right in 1907. And he loves these vertical pictures. A vertical format is, of course, a portrait format. It's not a landscape format, which is horizontal. And those terms are now obviously used in computer situations as well. But he loves this vertical format, and he paints it over and over again. In fact, he paints it 15 times, the most of any of these early water lily groupings. He seems to find it deeply satisfying. And in part, it's because the light comes down in the middle of this picture with this extraordinary swale opening up at the bottom, spilling out, greeting us, and allowing the water lilies themselves to move across the picture at the top, and therefore constructing really a horizontal rectangle. And then below the horizontal rectangle, you get essentially a square. So you get two shapes in one. If I have my little pointer, I hope you can see what I'm referring to. But where the break, or where the light begins to expand, that level of water lilies themselves, as they cut across the picture, form more or less a rectangle on top above a square. But he finds this deeply satisfying. He has his dealer come out, and he said, because the dealer had been wanting to have a show of these, dealer comes out, he hates these pictures. And we know that from a letter that Monet wrote to Durand Ruel after the dealer Durand Ruel comes, and he says, I'm so sorry you didn't like my pictures. I think, therefore, I won't hold the exhibition this year. Right? Durand Ruel was not pleased about this. But the following year, he does paint essentially square pictures that are pictures that are almost as if they've been breathed onto the surface. And they're so delicate that I did not want to compromise them by showing them to you. But nonetheless, the dealer comes out in 1908, sees these other pictures, says, let's have a show. Great, we love these pictures. And we're going to have a show of all of these series all the way through, which occurred in 1909. And he showed 48 of these water lily pictures to extraordinary acclaim. And it was, or it must have been, an amazing show. Never had so many single subjects been gathered in one place with such immense variation. Happily, as a little aside, some of you may have seen it, but back in 1990, we were able to organize an exhibition in Boston, Chicago, and London, where we actually had 24 of those original 48 water lilies for the first time since 1909. And I can tell you, to this very day, it gives me chills. I have goosebumps running up in my body right now. If I got hit by a crosstown bus after that show, it would have been fine. Just fine. Maybe not so fine for my wife or my kids, but you know, for me, it was deeply satisfying. And it revealed the power of these 1907 pictures. And in the 1909 show, Monet got back at the dealer, because the most number of pictures of any group were these 1907 paintings. And so there was something important about that. He stops more or less painting from 1909 until 1912, where he paints a number of pictures of Venice. And then he stops again. But when he takes up painting once more in 1914, as the guns of August are about to blare, what does he do? He goes back to the very same subject, back to the same format, in fact, although now not a vertical water lily, but in this particular case, that long vertical, this is a very big painting, so it would have been very difficult to do it on a vertical format. But you can see, yet once again, that light coming through the center, parting the darkness, so to speak, on either side of those rivulets of underground vegetation, and allowing those water lilies to float across the surface. And the more we look at these paintings, the more we ponder this light, the more the light takes on a kind of structure. It becomes a body of light. A body of light on a body of water. A body of light that parts the darkness and greets us with some kind of revelation, some sense of mystery, but some sense of presence. A presence that seems rather transcendental, rather unknown, rather mysterious. It is the body, however, that began to strike me as being perhaps the most important. And remembering that Monet wants to make art that is going to go down in history. These are not decorative, perfect, beautiful paintings. They have got more to them as a whole. And more you look at these paintings, the more that body of light becomes like the bodies of past art. Which is to say, here upon the left-hand side, these crucifixion scenes that are ubiquitous in early Renaissance painting, or in other ones such as this one here, where the body of Christ is rendered continuously in this very same fashion, this kind of arabesque as he hangs there from the cross with the kind of quasi-cherub water lilies up above there. That Monet wants, just like he did with the cathedral pictures, to make these pictures have the presence and the power of religious painting, even though they're not religious. to be able to combine the secular and the sacred, therefore, in something which is deeply human and accessible. And where does this get played out, finally, in the last minute together? It gets played out in the Angerie, in those great big monumental paintings, some of which are 20 feet long, as some of you know. Two rooms, which he designed himself, although he never saw them finished because he died in 1926, still working on them to the great regret of Clemenceau and others who wanted to get them on the walls. You come into the first room here, and it's been renovated, so it's glistening white marble and beautiful translucent light coming in from skylights up above, which had been the original plan. And you're wrapped by the, literally, by the poetry of these pictures which encircle these oval rooms. You then go through doors at the far right and left of that picture, pictures there, and you come into a second room. And as you come into the second room, the trees, his trees so close to his heart, they fill that room as well. They're filtering foliage coming down like boughs from heaven with, again, this startlingly sense of transcendence in terms of the actual water itself and the water lilies too. And then you turn around to go out. And when you turn around to go out, you're confronted with this painting, which is almost never illustrated in books on Monet. One, because it's actually very hard to photograph. This isn't a great photograph of it. Very hard to photograph. And two, it doesn't look like Monet, just like those industrial pictures I showed you at the beginning. But it's the first picture you see when you turn around and you're leaving this extraordinary experience. And it is dark. It's haunting. It's morose. It's actually really quite chilling as a picture. It's the contrast of this reverie that you have just been experiencing, the sense that painting can lift you and so on. And in fact, if you look at the center there, there is a dark form next to what looks like sort of two legs. There's a dark form that comes to the blue in the center there, and that is the reflection of the tree by his pond. A reflection of a tree, therefore, it's the absence of things, the absence of all of this beauty and poetry which he has been serving up with such abundance. Yes, there are a couple of little flowers there just to remind you, just to break the darkness of it all. But it is, in fact, a kind of confrontation with mortality and bringing you into a world that is steep and dark and difficult. And then you go out back into the first room. And a picture which would have been behind you when you came into that room, maybe you would have turned around, but most of the time you're sort of sucked by the elliptical quality of the room into the next room and so on. You come around and all of a sudden you're confronted with that painting there on the far wall, which occupies exactly the same position as the darker, morose picture of the previous room. And it's filled with this beautiful light, this sense of transformation, in those same beautiful colors of pinks and oranges and yellows, parting the darkness there yet once again, allowing us perhaps to feel the transcendence of, and the power of painting, to actually also perhaps experience what Monet had experienced in Spain in the second decade of the 20th century, where he went to Toledo expressly to see El Greco's great paintings, like this one here upon the left-hand side, where Christ is assumed up into heaven here from the resurrection, surrounded by saints and the Father, God the Father, such as perhaps is being expressed in the painting here at the end, so that when you leave this space, this secular space, and enter into the world itself, you will be recharged, you will be blessed, you will be in fact transformed by the power and poetry of a humble garden in Giverny. Thank you. I would assume that I'd be happy to take some questions. Is that legit? I'd be happy to. Any questions? I say to my students, no question is a dumb question because everybody else is thinking about that too. So if you have any questions whatsoever, I'd be happy to. Yes, sir.
Which is the best museum in Paris to see Monet?
Well, the Angerie is really a special place. It is truly a special place. And what I would urge you to do, if you have the time, is to actually, this is, I've only done it once, and that's why it remains with me. I've been to Giverny 1,000 times and so on and so forth. But one time, I actually had to go out there for something, and upon return to Paris, near the end of the day, I went to the Angerie. And that was a bookend that was absolutely immemorable. It was just fantastic. So you could actually see the real sight, experience it, smell it, feel it, and then go to see the transformation. So that's what I would urge you. Now, secondarily, the Musée Marmottan, which I had referenced a couple of times, has the largest number of late Monets. All of those pictures were given to Paul Marmottan, who became Claude Monet's son's best friend, Michel Monet, and Michel Monet had no heirs, so he gave essentially many of the paintings that had been in Monet's studio at Monet's death in 1926 and that had not been sold by the time Michel Monet in 1966 died. So that's quite an experience, and in that museum is also the Impression Sunrise that did not give Impressionism its name. Let's hear that. All right. All right. So that's slightly outside the heart of Paris, but those are two really. Yes, sir.
In terms of he was prolific, but in terms of I was just trying to do the numbers when you were talking about the 2,000 paintings and all that. Right. That meant that he did one a week.
He actually, over the course of essentially 80 years, and there were some years where he painted nothing. There were other years where, for example, this picture would only count as one, even though it's 20 feet long. That essentially he painted a picture every 5 to 6 weeks for that whole period of time. He was enormously productive. And you know, not every picture is terrific. I'm honest enough to say that. But he hits it more often than not. And even if it's not really working so well, there's something interesting that he's exploring it. He does not like to repeat himself just for the sake of repetition. You know, he only painted 20 of those stack pictures. He probably could have painted 40 of them and sold them like hotcakes. They all sold out during the exhibition. But he was very rigorous and very hard on himself too. He also was tricky because for some of the cathedral pictures, for example, he was going to charge 15,000 francs, which at the time was quite a bit of money. And his dealer said, "Oh, that's too much." So what does he do? He said, "No, 15's the number." He then turns around, he sells a couple to other people for 12. So he goes back and says, "Yeah, I've sold some." And Durand-Ruel therefore actually kicks in and buys other at 15, so that of course when the catalog comes out, it's going to have the names of the owners, so that people coming to the show, if they want to get on the train, they better get on the train because these things are already being snapped up. So the point really is he was a great marketeer among anything else. Yes, ma'am.
I was there last summer at the Lingerie, and one of the guides mentioned that the different colors at certain periods he were darker because he had a vision problem. And that when he didn't see the colors as vibrantly, then
right.
He had surgery.
Right.
Is that true?
Well, there are parts of it that are true and there are parts that are not. The part that is true is that he did have cataracts. They were diagnosed in 1912, and he had one of his eyes operated on in 1922. And he must have been the worst patient possible. Mm-hmm. As you could imagine, anybody who's going to be a painter living as long as he did and rely upon his sight, he would just be completely flummoxed by it. And he was terrible afterwards, so on and so forth. Even though the operation went just fine. It took him a long time to recover. He went through lots of different glasses and was very experimental to be able to get it right. The fallacy is the same fallacy that often is associated with Impression Sunrise, which did not give Impressionism its name. And that is that because of these cataracts, both the late pictures like this one here upon the right, were actually becoming, quote unquote, more abstract or blurrier, and the colors would change as well. Now, you know, one can never put oneself into somebody else's body, and so it's very hard to really recreate what he was seeing or what he was thinking about. Despite the many letters that he writes, He does talk about saying that he is sometimes choosing colors by knowing the tube that the color is. But here's the bottom line. He invested everything in these late pictures, which is why he didn't want to give them up. They literally had to be pried out from him at death's door. And therefore, he liked everything that he was doing and seeing. And in point of fact, many of the late pictures are perfectly legible. They are not as crisp and as academic and as clear as earlier ones, but that was just his normal trajectory as well. And that if he had not liked what he was seeing or doing, he actually would have destroyed it, because we know that he destroyed up to 100 paintings. He began editing his own work later in life so that history would only be written by himself, which is one of the things he was very keen on controlling. So those tales are, again, the easy tales of a lion. He's going blind, he can't see, pictures get blurrier, he doesn't have the right color choices, and so on and so forth. But it's really actually much more complicated than that. So, which is actually a happy thing in the end. It's really a happy phenomenon. Yes, sir.
I wonder, is there anything you could tell us about Monet's relationship with two of his contemporaries, first Pierre Bonnard, since we have this exhibition coming up, or by chance, maybe Camille Pissarro, who's an artist whose politics have always fascinated me.
Right.
So I'm just curious about, you know, relationships with some of these peers.
Yeah. One of the wonderful but sort of slightly unfortunate things is that Monet hardly talks about other artists, which on the one hand is very complimentary. He doesn't badmouth anybody. Really doesn't badmouth anybody. Pizarro badmouths Gauguin, you know, saying Gauguin is ripping off all those primitives. He's un-French. He's terrible. But Monet is very silent on all of that, or at least the letters that have come down to us, which are over 2,000. So there's a lot of documentation. There's virtually no relationship or no construct between him and Bonnard, which is slightly surprising, because Bonnard undoubtedly admired him a great deal. You know, by that time, he really wasn't a recluse in Giverny, because he came in for dinners in Paris all the time. So there inevitably probably was some contact, but there's no actual evidence thereof. With someone like Pizarro, really tight. I mean, he even lent Pizarro, although not quite at usury rates, but he lent Pizarro money so that Pizarro could buy his house in the 1890s. He had great respect for him. I think that Pizarro, obviously, as you know, was much farther to the left than Monet was, but I think he admired that kind of political stance. Certainly Monet, happily, was very much a Dreyfusard, meaning he supported Dreyfus. He even wrote to Zola, who was supporting Dreyfus and got charged with libel and got rolled up into trial as well. He wrote to Zola saying, "Bravo, bravo, you have done exactly what needs to be done." Really terrific kinds of things. And Pizarro was obviously a great supporter too. We know, for example, between Pizarro and Degas, that Degas completely cut Pizarro off after that. Pizarro was a Jew, and Degas had this anti-Semitism. And from that moment onwards, he never talked to Pizarro again. It was just flat as that. But there was a real warmth between Pizarro and Pizarro's children, too, which Monet took under his wing and greatly appreciated. Voila. Oops. So sorry. I didn't see you. Yes. Thank you.
I was very intrigued by the moment that you said competition is innate to Monet.
Yeah.
Because I think maybe we don't think of him or talk about him enough as a competitor. And I wondered if you might state your own opinion as to who he's in competition with the most. Himself, Lorraine, Greco, the modernists, Manet? Who is his great
Everybody. Yeah, I completely agree with you, and I love it. There's nothing wrong with it. Good competition. I mean, heck, that's the nature of the deal, right? And as I always say to my students, all art comes from other art. This doesn't come out of the blue like that, or from other art things. But I think it's really, enriching. In fact, in 1865, when Monet's picture, that first picture was shown at the exhibition, Manet apparently got very upset. Like, who is this guy Monet? You know, what's this guy doing? And it reminded me of a tale, if I may digress, that that was told to me by the head of the National Gallery in Washington many years ago, Carter Brown. He said that he had been standing in the galleries at the National Gallery and had heard two people who were looking at this Manet painting. And they go up, one person goes up to the label and comes back and he says, "Now, that says Manet, but I thought it was Monet." And the other person says, "Well, I've heard it both ways, so I guess both are okay." But Manet apparently got a little, skinned by some of that. And there is even, back to your question, Chris, there's even a wonderful reference when Renoir and Manet are both with Monet in Argenteuil in 1874, and they're painting literally in Monet's backyard. And Manet and Renoir paint a picture of Camille, his wife, and a rooster. They had a rooster in the backyard. And Manet apparently said to Monet afterwards, you know, about Renoir, he says, he really should just give up painting. Now, whether that's true or apocryphal, I don't know. But I think that it really adds an important edge, an important context. I make a joke saying everybody, you know, he was, as I say, very much in competition with himself, but he always hears the voices of his predecessors, and he hears the breath of his contemporaries. He was endowed with great talent early on and was recognized even by by people in Saint-Adresse. A wonderful diary came to light about 10 years ago where a friend of the Monet family had taken this diary and had been kind of a pupil of Monet as a teenager. And Monet would take them out on sketching excursions, which was why we know that he drew a lot more than what has come down to us. And the person says that he is a superb draftsman. He's a great teacher, but he is, you know, extremely aggressive about making art as well. And he felt so endowed. Not that he was an arrogant guy per se, although I'm not quite sure how much that may work, but even in the 1860s, in his 30s, he is sharing a studio with Frederick Bazille, the wonderful artist from Montpellier who died in the Franco-Prussian War and who came from a very wealthy family in the South. And Bazille is back at his family house, and Monet's starving away, so to speak, in his studio in Paris, a shared studio. And he says, "I really think you should send me a case of wine. I mean, after all, you have plenty of it down there, and I deserve it." So he did believe, and people acquiesced to that sense of talent. But if you have that talent, you have to be able to figure out how to deploy it appropriately and how to be able to make the most of it. The fact that he goes right after Manet with that huge picture, which was going to make Manet's painting look like a postage stamp, you know, is a keen indication of how big his ego could be. You know, here he's just a kid virtually, and the painting, as I say, was going to be this Courbet-like sizable entity. He was very good friends with Courbet, and Courbet was actually at his wedding and so on. But that sense of competition sort of was just a part of his DNA. So if anybody's got to getting too close or this, that, another thing, he'd chew them up. One final point in that regard, not to go on, but the younger generation in the 1880s, the generation of Seurat and the neo-impressionists, the pointillists, the dot guys, he found aberrant. And the only comment he ever made about sort of somebody else's art, he made it as an aside to Mary Cassatt in the 1890s, and he said, "Nature is not made up of little dots." Boom, end of story. But Seurat was such a good artist, he recognized he was such a good artist, that Monet goes off and does pictures that are directly confrontational or directly in competition with Seurat, because he knows that this younger generation is nipping him in the heels. And by that time, of course, he's, you know, 45 years old and moving on through life. And all of a sudden you have someone who really fundamentally understands Impressionism, but is turning it now into this kind of mechanical, industrial look, which he felt was really inappropriate to art. But it's great to think about that way with lots of other artists too. So I really appreciate that question. Well, thank you ever so much. Really, you've been wonderful. I really appreciate it. Thank you.